In thrust we trust. And thrust is of course measured in kilonewtons. Support my channel and spaceflight in general by buying the new The Official KNews Space merch at shop.kNews.space. This is shop.kNews.space. Get your very own wings today. Black holes are among the most mysterious objects in the sky, but how dangerous are they? I want to explore this very question a little now on KNews. Hey guys, Lucas here. Welcome to KNews, and as always a big shout out to you, my crowdfunding buddies, my KNews boosters on Patreon. Thanks for your trust. Hold. Before I talk about the dark side, let me give you a quick update on recent rocket launches. For the US, there was a SpaceX Falcon 9 that launched on June 29th from Cape Canaveral. Up top was another Dragon spacecraft, part of the commercial resupply services for the International Space Station. It's number 15 already, but still an older version 1 capsule. Sadly, no Dragon 2 yet, guys. But speaking of Dragon 2, there is some progress being made. SpaceX's new spaceship was recently put to the test in NASA's biggest vacuum chamber that can simulate the rigors of space like temperature gradients. It basically gets toasted on one side and the heat stripped away from the other to stress the entire body as it bends and twists from the expansion forces. I'm not sure of the outcome yet, but I guess it's unlikely for it to break since, well, SpaceX flies upper stages and Dragons in space already and nothing teared apart so far. So I assume they know what they're doing. Dragon looks a little rough in this image, but that is going to change as there are some parts missing and SpaceX will make sure it looks pretty on its maiden flight. Another launch happened in China a little earlier on June 27th, more precisely in Xichang. It's a Long March 2C carrying three satellites of type Yaogan and a secondary payload for the Shanghai Micro Satellite Engineering Center called WiNA. I'm not entirely sure what it does, but Yaogan are part of China's spicy reconnaissance fleet in low Earth orbit. And lastly, there was an Electron, which was pushed back and delayed, which is still supposed to launch from New Zealand. While the company Rocket Lab is based in the US, I still count that one for New Zealand because, well, I like Kiwis since they sound like KNews. On top are multiple Kiwi-sized nanosatellites from different entities, and I want to highlight Irvine-01, which was built by US students in a joint project called Irvine CubeSat STEM Program. The satellite will take pictures of Venus and other stars to make use of the so-called parallax effect as it orbits Earth. Close stars like Venus shift much more than other distant ones, so one can derive a three-dimensional map of the sky using just the information of its images. Such 3D maps also give important clues to maybe invisible things in space, things we cannot see through regular telescopes, hiding and lurking behind a cover of darkness. Yes, these are of course black holes I'm talking about. I personally find the name black hole a little misleading, but it got stuck for what is essentially just a black star. A star forms from collapsing gas clouds in space, very similar to gas giants like Jupiter. What you see here is a little simulation I wrote based on Newtonian physics, and this shall just prove that all further animations, with the simulation icon to the lower right, are not just made up but act very similar if not identical to real planets and stars. I could in fact never control the movements of so many objects by hand, and if you are still skeptical, you can of course look for errors in some of the celestial body movements. They are all equal in mass and occupy the region that is roughly as big as our inner solar system. Back at a star formation, the amount of gas collapsing into a single object is much bigger than that of a gas giant, so that the star generates enough pressure in its core for fusion to begin. Fusing atom cores or nuclei together requires immense forces because they repel each other, as they are made of protons and neutrons and are therefore positively charged. Once they get close enough though, other forces that keep the protons themselves together take over and the two cores snap together rapidly, as if a barrier was crushed. Depending on what elements fuse, this process releases a lot of energy which heats up the star's core to many, many millions of degrees Celsius. Life would actually be impossible near a star if there wasn't that hundreds of thousands of kilometers thick gas cloud covering the hot core, which is also necessary to generate that pressure in first place. So we don't have to fear that this cloud could be blown away off our sun anytime soon, since the star would not be able to sustain such a strong fusion without it. But at some point, as a star's fusion gets more intense with age, the core temperature gets hotter and hotter, fusing elements together even at the most outer layers. This is where a star blows up to many times its size until its core extinguishes, causing the entire star to collapse. This collapse or implosion causes some massive star clouds to bounce back, exploding into outer space, a supernova. It spreads the new elements it created around the galaxy, causing nearby gas clouds to collapse in a billion-year chain reaction, forming new stars and systems as the universe ages. Just by the way, a supernova, while similar, is not directly related to a nova. The terms got a little mixed up right there, since a regular nova is a star explosion caused by one star feeding from another and not one star blowing up on its own. Anyways, the remains most commonly shrink, forming a white or black dwarf star. For extremely massive stars, however, this is where it really gets interesting. The dwarf they leave behind is a neutron star, where you couldn't lift a single scoop of matter with the strongest of machines. A cubic meter has a mass of millions of tons, unimaginably heavy. Such a neutron star is the only glimpse we have at the formation of black holes. They are essentially the last step before matter collapses into the abyss, into nothing, a single point with zero space, the famous singularity. Full disclosure, I'm not a physicist, but to get an idea how this is possible at all, one has to know that the size of matter as we know it is only based on the fundamental forces of nature. A solid surface looks solid to us because of the way light bounces off it, and it feels solid because of the way the surface atoms interact with our bodies. We can't push our hand through it because there is a force stopping us, and it is nothing but a force. Given enough pressure, you could push your hand through everything, assuming that the force would not crush the hand itself. What I try to say is, even the smallest of elements that take up a certain space do that based on these strange forces that just exist with yet unknown origin. This hopefully helps to illustrate that when the outside pressure caused by gravity wins, they can collapse indefinitely. There is no known boundary or limit to how small matter or energy can be compressed by gravity. Thinking about black holes, it is therefore important to know that these are giant stars carrying the same mass, just collapse into spaces so small we cannot see them anymore. What we instead see or not observe is a region surrounding them where the gravity gets so intense that everything that falls behind it is trapped forever, even light. The distance from the singularity where this region begins is the so-called Schwarzschild or Schwarzschild radius, and it can range from just a few kilometers for small black holes or up to millions of kilometers for supermassive ones, like the one holding our galaxy together in the center of our Milky Way. The literal translation of Schwarzschild from German, by the way, is Black Shield Radius, which is ironically quite fitting. However, it is actually a German astrophysicist's name, Karl Schwarzschild, so it's not a term you would translate. While the inner workings of a black hole are known and matter of speculation, everything outside of the Schwarzschild radius is very well understood. The gravity of a black hole is not different from that of stars and other bodies, even ourselves. The black hole in our galaxy's center is not sucking up the galaxy as one would maybe imagine. The tens of billions of stars just orbit it on peaceful and stable orbits, like our solar system does for now billions of years, with a couple dozen round trips so far. The dangerous black holes I want to talk about are not the giant ones in centers of galaxies. I want to talk about relatively small, rogue black holes that zip around the Milky Way like our sun does. Unlike our sun, they are invisible and they can only be observed indirectly by either a glowing disk of matter surrounding them or the warp in space-time they create. Gravity warps space-time, forming a giant three-dimensional funnel, a little like this. This funnel is the reason why we are glued to our planet's surface and don't fall off into space. So, keeping track and mapping the 3D space of our surrounding stars is therefore vital to find such rogue black holes. The danger does not lie in the black hole itself, though, at least according to my simulations. A direct hit with our sun or our Earth is very unlikely due to their incredibly small size, but that doesn't mean it's harmless. Our solar system balances itself out for billions of years and is much more fragile than one would imagine. To illustrate this, I can again use my little simulation tool and plug in the numbers for our solar system. It now shows how the real orbiting bodies would be affected by a flyby of the most lightest of black holes, just a couple times heavier than our sun. The camera is locked to the sun, so the point it leaves behind is its origin as it gets attracted towards the incoming threat. And here it comes from the top. Whoa, it really scared the hell out of me when I saw this for the first time. I never really thought about the dangers of just a seemingly innocent flyby. The black hole would fling most of the solar system's planets deep into space and separate us from our host star, or, as seen here, throw us directly into it. Our future friends on Mars are not much better off. I simulated it hundreds of years into the future and it will end up crashing into the Sun as well as Jupiter gives it a deadly gravity assist. This means just moving to a neighboring planet is not the final solution to save humanity and possibly life for an eternity. We have to move out to different stars in the long run if we want to sustain us and our surroundings. But falling into the Sun has actually a rather low chance and I use this for the dramatic effect. The by far most common outcome in all the simulations I ran is a slingshot into deep space. Black holes are multiple times more heavy than our Sun, so such slingshots are incredibly powerful. Now, I don't want to leave you worrying about such a dark future. We as humans are thankfully very good at dealing with never before seen problems and science will allow us to identify such threats long before they actually put our lives at risk. We would become the guardians of the Earth as we'd use our knowledge of fusion power to create our own Sun, or multiple ones. Double Sun power! But seriously, we could fuse hydrogen like the Sun does to warm up the planet, even without a star, so I am very positive that even such a worst case scenario would not be the end of all life as we know it. The foundations to this are currently being laid at many places and one of them is ITER, or International Thermonuclear Experimental Reactor. The biggest ever experimental fusion reactor that is supposed to generate power is being built in Europe as I speak. But the first step would probably be to seek shelter below the ground to make use of our own planet's heat source, thereby nuclear fission driven thermal activities deep down below the Earth's crust. For that we need boring machines and whatnot, which is of course also being worked on, but that's maybe a story for another video. Have you ever thought about black holes flying by our Sun? Tell me what you think about it. Okay, that shall conclude this episode and I hope to see you in the next one if you like. Auf Wiedersehen and thank you for watching.